Hello. Today I'm going to talk about future life cycles and mess around with cancelling a long-running stream in Tokio 0.1. Intervals, as you may know, are a type of stream in Tokio. An interval emits a value at a regular time interval of your choosing, maybe once per second. The annoying thing about them is that they run forever, so unless you have a clear plan for how they're going to end, you might leak tasks that you can only stop by shutting down your entire runtime. But first, let's recap briefly how futures get created and destroyed. When we have some sort of asynchronous work to do, we bundle it all up into one big self-contained entity, and that whole thing is a future. Then we spawn it onto the Tokio runtime, where it becomes a task, an ongoing process that the executor is managing. In doing so, we give ownership of the future and all its associated data to Tokio. Now, why do we need to give up ownership? Well, this task might be alive much longer than the stack memory of the code that created it. Obviously, in this program, the future is going to finish before main does, but this is an unusually simple case. In general, all references in the future are required to have a static lifetime. The Tokio runtime is a long-running piece of code in the background, so it can hold on to all of this for us. For the developer, the static requirement is kind of annoying, which is one of the main benefits of the upcoming async await syntax in Future 0.3 and Tokio 0.2. But for today, we're talking about old-school static futures. So the overall process is this. First, we create a future. We might use combinators like and then to change it around, which is fine, so long as the whole thing is some variety of future. We move in any required data, either via parameters or by making a move closure. Second, we pass the whole thing to the async executor by spawning it, giving up ownership as we do so. Third, maybe the task will eventually finish, and when it does, the executor will drop it. In this test program, I don't want to have any tasks that run forever. For this exercise, I'm trying to avoid that. So instead of calling shutdown now on the runtime, which brutally ends all tasks that are still in progress, I'm using shutdown on idle. This waits patiently until all spawn tasks have finished. My program will only be allowed to terminate if the tasks clean themselves up properly. Now, let's have a play with this. This first program is extremely simple. It creates a delay, which will wait 3 seconds and print a message to screen. Let's see it in action. Magnificent. It looks like it worked. But has it really cleaned up my future? Did this delay and its associated data get dropped? Tokio is kind of a black box here. Let's add some more logging and instrumentation. I've made a couple of changes here. The main thing I've done is create a new struct called tracker. The job of tracker is to print to screen when it gets created, and again when it gets dropped. If I create one and move it inside my future's data, I will be able to see on screen when that particular future instance gets dropped. To make the tracker part of the future, I'm calling a dummy method on it called retain. It doesn't actually do anything, but it tells the compiler that the tracker needs to belong to this closure. Let's run this and have a look at the log output. Okay, we saw that delay. Let's take this line by line. First, we see the line where our tracker was created. After that, we created and spawned our future, but this doesn't cause anything to be printed yet, not until the delay is finished. So the main thread continues straight down to waiting for the runtime to become idle. It blocks there because our delay task is still running. 3 seconds later, the timer expires, so we see the timer up message. Now we see our tracker was dropped. Excellent, our future is definitely gone. Now the runtime is idle and the program ends. Now, using a delay is kind of boring because we intuitively expect that the task will come to an end. Let's now move to an interval. If you want to do something every time an interval fires, an easy way to do that is with for each. This lets you provide a closure that will be run each time it fires. It also has the effect of transforming the stream into a future, which means it's something you can spawn on the executor. The rule of for each is that your closure must return a future, or something that can be interpreted as a future, such as a result. If it's a successful future, like OK, then it will wait until the next stream value arrives. If it's a failed future, like error, then it will stop processing the stream and end. Here we are going to loop from 1 to 5 at 1 second intervals, where this closure returns OK the first 4 times, then error. We expect this to end the overall task, and again I'm using a tracker to make sure I can see this clearly. Let's run this. As expected, the task ended, and the interval and its associated tracker were dropped. The runtime is idle, and the app ends. In many situations, this is quite good. If the interval task knows when it has to end, either because of its own data, or by sharing data with the outside world via a mutex, you can have it cancel itself like this. But it's not super obvious code, and you have to make sure that synchronization with the outside world is working correctly to avoid leaking this interval. Now, imagine we have some sort of Tokio task of finite duration that's doing some processing. And as long as that task is running, it needs to have an interval running in the background to do some sort of related housekeeping work. We don't know in advance how long the interval needs to run, we just want it to last the same amount of time as the main task. It would be bad if the interval ended early, and it would also be bad if it kept running after the main task ended. Here's some example code mimicking this situation. The interval is still there, but I've changed it so that it just loops upward forever, printing higher and higher numbers. The important processing task is represented here as a delay. For this demo, it's going to finish after 6 seconds, and what we want is the interval to end at the same time no matter what. Let's run this version. As you can see, the delay ended and its tracker was dropped, but the interval keeps going forever, and our runtime never gets to shut down. This is exactly the situation that I want to avoid. I want to point out quickly that I'm only using delay as an example. In a real application, the main processing task might be related to a user interaction or a network request or something. We don't know how long it's actually going to take, but in this demo, we're going to pretend it always takes 6 seconds. If what you want to do is put a fixed time limit on a future or a stream in Tokyo, you should check out the timeout module. This is much cleaner than what I'm about to demonstrate. So how can we tie the lifespans of these two tasks together? This is a good fit for a function called select. Here I have used select in the code. This takes two futures and merges them into one future, which I've called combined. As soon as either of them completes, the combined select future will complete. Let's try to build and run this. Spoiler alert, it won't work, as you might be able to see from the red squiggles. The problem is that the future returned by select provides tuples for both the value and error types. We can see that in the documentation. Here, future item type is this tuple of two values and error type is this tuple of two values. This is one of those fun situations where the compiler shows the error message kind of backwards, expected tuple found unit type. The spawn method is expecting a future that completes with the unit type, but select is giving it a tuple with two values in it instead. Tokyo wants us to decide what to do with this data. In this case, let's just drop either the value or the error, whichever we happen to get. This will simply pass it to the drop function. Let's try that. Four, five, six. How good is that? Our interval stream, which was never designed to stop, has been dropped, and the runtime has become idle and shut down. Perfect. In practice, this might be all you need, but let's dig a little bit more into what's going on after the select. When we just drop the values, we're masking something interesting. Here I've changed the code so that instead of dropping what select gives us, we accept the tuple values and print the success or error result values to the screen. Let's run this one instead. This time, the printout shows that we received an empty tuple, a successful empty tuple from our first future. We know that this came from the delay. Now, look at this. The interval future was dropped after printing out this message. When we're doing this print line, select has already finished. So why is the other future still hanging around at this point? Well, the future which hasn't finished yet is actually this second part of the tuple. Tokio has given ownership of the interval back to us. Here, we just drop it on the ground and forget about it, but we don't necessarily have to do that. Let's try kicking it off again. This time, we respawn the interval task, and we can see it picks up exactly where it left off, on loop 7. Since it now has nothing to stop it, the executor will never become idle, and I have to terminate the app manually. Obviously, you wouldn't normally want to do this because we've just undone our hard work, but it's another tool for the toolbox. That's all for today. Cheerio!